Hello friends, in this tutorial we will talk about basics of algorithms. So let's start with the very first question. What are algorithms? So algorithm is a well-defined computational procedure. So that means like any other procedure, algorithm must have a set of inputs as well as set of outputs. The second thing is it can serve as a tool for solving a well-specified computational problem. So well-specified means the template for permissible input as well as output is very well defined, and the algorithm will serve as a tool for solving it. So, and in other words, we can say that algorithm describes a specific computational procedure for achieving the given input-output relationship, which is specified by the computational problem. So from all this, we must be able to understand the key difference between procedure and algorithm. The first difference is whenever we talk about any procedure, right, then we are not sure whether this particular procedure will halt, whether this particular procedure will stop, whether this particular procedure will terminate or not. But when we talk about any algorithm, then we are sure that this particular, when we talk about algorithms, and we are sure that they will definite, they will be terminating, right? Otherwise there is no use of it, right? So that is the first difference. The second difference is if we consider this particular input-output relationship, then it means that the algorithm must achieve this desired relationship, right? Then only it makes sense, right? So in other words, we can say that the algorithm must be correct, right? So whenever we design any algorithm, we must make sure that the algorithm terminates as well as it terminates with correct output. So in this video, we are going to talk about two computational problems for better understanding of algorithms. So let's start with the very first computational problem. The problem is of sorting. So it means input is a sequence of n numbers, like let's say a1, a2, a3, up to n, and output is, again, output will contain the same numbers but in a specific order, right? So this particular order follows this rule. The first element is less than or equal to second element is less than or equal to third element, and so on, right? So now when we talk about algorithm, then we must make sure that this particular input-output relationship is specified. So from this, one more observation is there is no single algorithm, right? One can derive, depending upon the problem, one can have more than one algorithms for solving that particular problem. In this particular case, for example, we can either use selection sort or bubble sort or merge sort or quick sort and so on, right? And even before that, one can ask what is so special about this particular computational problem? Why do we even require algorithm to solve this particular problem? So the problem is, if you understand this definition clearly, then the sequence, talk about sequence of n numbers, then there are n factorial different permutations are possible, and out of this n factorial permutation, we are looking for a specific permutation which follows this particular rule. So naturally, if we increase the value of n, then total number of permutations will increase drastically, and hence we require some mechanism to figure it out, which is the permutation which follows this particular rule. In other words, which permutation is the sorted permutation corresponding to the given permutation, okay? Okay, so let's consider a few examples. So let's say my input is 35, 14, 5, 3, 21, and 18. Then output must be like this: 3, 5, 14, 18, 21, and 35. Similarly, if my input is like this, then output must be like this in sorted order. So the second problem is of greatest common divisor. So input is two non-negative integers, let's say m and n, and the output is greatest common divisor, GCD, of m and n. will see two different algorithms to solve this particular problem of GCD. And now we will go one step further. Now, in the previous problem, we know that for the any given problem, there can be more than one algorithms. Now, we will see two different algorithms for this particular problem. And in some sense, we will try to compare these two algorithms. We will compare in terms of number of mathematical operations. So the next question is why we are considering a number of mathematical operations in order to compare two algorithms. Why not some different any other mechanism to do so? So the answer is how much time that required by a particular implementation of an algorithm depends upon your machine, right? So for example, if I implement an algorithm A in smartphone, then it may require, let's say, 1 second, but the same algorithm can run in, let's say, 1 microsecond if you run it on supercomputer. So therefore, our analysis must be independent of machine, right? So we require some mechanism which is machine independent. So irrespective of where we run this particular algorithm, the number of mathematical operations will remain constant, right? So therefore we'll focus on number of mathematical operations in order to compare two algorithms. So let's start with very first algorithm to solve this particular problem. Before that, let's consider a few examples. GCD of 54 and 24 is 6, GCD of 48 and 120 is 12. And we must make sure that our derived algorithm or whatever algorithm we are using, that algorithm must work for all possible or permissible inputs, not for just these two. Okay, so I guess all of you are familiar with this particular standard prime factorization based algorithm. So what we will do, first we'll factorize m into prime factors. So let's say m is equal to m1 into m2 into m3 up to mp1. Similarly, we'll factorize n. So n is equal to n1 into n2 into n3 up to np2. And now what we'll do, we will find out common factors and then we will multiply it, and that will be the answer, right? So let's say common factors are c1, c2, c3 up to cp. Then c1 into c2 into c3 into cp, that is nothing but GCD. So I guess all of you are familiar with this particular standard algorithm. Now we'll consider Euclid's algorithm. So the next solution is namely Euclid's algorithm, and here we are assuming that value of m is greater than n, and since value of m is greater than n, we will be able to find out m modulo n. So in this particular algorithm, basically in the each iteration of this particular while loop, we are changing values of m and n, and once value of n becomes 0, at that time we will return value of m, and this particular modified m is nothing but GCD of original two values. So effectively we are changing values like this: value of n will go to value of m, and m modulo n will go to n. And after repeated application of this particular relation, we reach to this particular state where two values are like this, m comma 0, and since m divides itself and m also divides 0, the GCD of m comma 0 will be nothing but m. So now from this one can observe that talking about correctness of this particular algorithm, one should observe that this particular algorithm will eventually terminate. Why? So if you observe this, then new value of m is nothing but old value of n, and since m is greater than n, we are reducing the value of m in each iteration. So that means we can say that m will be decreased at least by 1 in each iteration. Now, what can we say about value of n? So now, if you check here, then value of n is nothing but, new value of n is nothing but m modulo n. And since value of m modulo n can be at most n minus 1, we can say that value of n will be also decrease at least by once. So that means in each iteration, value of m as well as n will be decreased by at least 1, and hence we will reach to this particular state where value of n will become 0, and at that time we will use this particular base case in order to get our answer. So now we will, in some sense, we will compare these two algorithms. So how we will do it? We will consider examples. So let's say value of m is 180, value of n is 48, and let's apply algorithm 1. So in algorithm 1, we will first find out prime factors for 180. So those are nothing but 2, 2, 3, 3, 5, and then we will find out factors of 48 also, and then common factors are 2, 2 and 3. So the answer is 2 into 2 into 3, which is nothing but 12. But now let's analyze this, how many divisions we are doing. So here, if you focus on this 4 terms, then we can say that at least 4 divisions we are doing, and then the next prime is 5, and we know that after dividing 5 with 5 we will get 1. So we are doing ultimately at least 4 divisions here. Similarly, we are doing at least 4 divisions here, and so we can say that total we are doing 8 divisions for these two numbers, right? Remember, this analysis is just for this pair. It's not, we can't generalize it, right? Now let's try to solve this using solution 2, which is nothing but Euclid's algorithm. So here what we will do, we'll first assign this 48 to m, and then we will do 180 modulo 48, which is nothing but 36. So this is my first iteration, and we have done just one division so far. Now again we'll assign this 36 as a new m, and then we'll do 48 modulo 36, which is nothing but 12. This is my new n, and we have reached from here to here by doing one division. So this was also one division, this is also one more division. Now let's repeat the process. Now this 12 will become my new n, and 36 modulo 12 is nothing but 0, since 12 divides 36. So we will reach to this particular state where value of n is 0. So at that time, whatever. So once I reach to this particular state, GCD of 12 comma 0, so here value of n is 0. So whatever value of m is there, that will be my answer. So my answer is 12. So as you can see, using both the approaches, we are getting the same answer, 12. But if you count number of divisions, then here we are doing 8 divisions, whereas here we are doing, if we use Euclid's algorithm, then we are doing just 3 divisions. So one is for this transition, one is for this transition, and one more is for this transition. So basically, using just 3 divisions, we are reaching to a solution. Now let me take 2 different values. Let's say my m is 1668 and n is 338. So, and again we are repeating the same process, and again GCD is same. Okay, for these two numbers also we are getting 12 as the final answer in both the cases. But now if you focus on number of divisions, then what will happen? After 3 divisions we'll reach to this particular state, and now we will try to factor 139, because we don't know whether 139 is prime or not. So what we'll do, we'll do number of divisions, right? And we'll consider all the value, all the prime numbers which are between 3 and let's say 139, right? And if we do this intelligently, then maybe we can reduce these numbers by some factor, at least by a factor of 2. But still, we require a lot of divisions in order to make sure that we are actually getting this, right? Same is with this, right? If we reach to this particular point, then again, in order to figure it out whether 29 is prime or not, again, we'll try to factor it out with 5, then 7, then 11, and so on, right? So, in summary, we can say many divisions are required, right? But now, if you try to solve the same problem using Euclid's algorithm, then you can do this with just 6 divisions, right? So again, like initially we will change this 348 to m, and then we will do 1668 modulo 348, that is nothing but 276, and then again we will go to this particular state when 276 will become new m, and then 348 modulo 276, which is nothing but 72, will become new n, and then again after one more division we'll get this, after one more division we'll get this, after one more division again we'll reach to this particular state where value of n is 0, and hence we will return m, which is nothing but 12. So using just 6 divisions we are getting the final answer. So now if you try to compare these two algorithms, then solution 1 versus solution 2, then in some sense you can say that solution 2, right, which is nothing but Euclid's algorithm, is fast. In other words, we can say that it's efficient solution, right? But still, we need to formalize this. So before we formalize this in terms of asymptotic notation, one more thing is missing. So you must be convinced that this particular Euclid's algorithm will always give us the correct answer. So here I have explained you about the second criteria, which means nothing but this particular algorithm will halt, it will eventually terminate, that is clear from this particular observation. But what about correctness? In order to prove the correctness of this particular algorithm, we must show that this particular relation, after each iteration of while loop, my GCD is not changing. That we must prove. So that means we must prove that GCD of m comma n is equal to GCD of n comma m modulo n. This proof, I will give this particular proof in the next lecture. Thank you. Subscribe to my channel for more videos.